it must be cold outside. When I came here this morning, I started the truck, and it said -6. And then once it warmed up, it went down to -8. But by the time I came to church, it was back up to -6. So it was cold. You may have noticed, if you watched the Wednesday morning 10 a.m. Facebook Live Bible study, that I talked about smashed avocados. Smashed avocados. Yeah, guacamole. You would think that that would be, you know, who doesn't? I love guacamole. I love avocados. Well, so what I like to do is just get the avocado, cut it in half, and then spoon out and eat half, and then later in the day eat the other half. Well, a normal person, when they pack their lunch, would use a lunchbox or a bag or something like that. Not me. So on Tuesday morning, I'm ready and raring to go come to church. Because, you know, last week, the first week of the month of the new year, I was sick, just under the weather, and just, you know, I didn't really feel like doing much. So, okay, Lord, here we are, back at it. Let's go stick the avocado in my coat pocket. Well, on Tuesday morning, I was driving my plow truck to church to kind of clear some of the stuff that needed to be, that hadn't gotten done yet. And it's a little bit higher than, you know, I'm used to jumping into. So when I went to jump up into the truck, the avocado that was bulging out of my pocket became a wedge, and I got stuck. It stopped me from going into the seat. Well, that poor avocado had no chance against my 235 pounds coming against it. So I then had squished avocado, smashed avocado in my pocket. And I stuck my hand in, which then had stuff all over it. So in frustration, I just threw it on the driveway at home. Why am I telling you that story? Well, at that moment, I was like, come on. What's happening? I'm ready to get going. Things are going good. And I got smashed avocado all over the place. Have you ever had that happen where you think things are going to, you know, go one way and then boom, trip up, mess up, things happen? You know, it's at that point that your day, your choice of either making that day go well or that day not go well. How are you using your faith? And that happens a lot of times in our faith journey too, where we are getting disappointed by things that happen, things that go wrong. Unless we realize that even with the smushed avocados, that life is still good, that God is still with us, and we can persevere. Romans 12:12 talks about how we are to be patient in suffering or patient in affliction and faithful in prayer. And so in times like that, that's what we are. We're joyful in hope, patient in affliction, and faithful in prayer. So today, we are in our second Sunday of Epiphany, and our first scripture reading comes from Psalms. And so we have three readings today, and they deal with revelation, they deal with identity, they deal with seeing with eyes of faith. So Psalm 139. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. You search out my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely. You hem me in behind me and before, and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain it. For it was you who formed my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works that I know very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes beheld my unformed substance. In your book were written all the days that were formed for me, when none of them as yet existed. How weighty to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them. I try to count them. They are more than the sand. I come to the end, and I am still with you. Amen.
Amen. All right, now the scripture reading is from 1 Samuel chapter 3, verses 1 through 10. Let's start from the beginning. Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called, "Samuel, Samuel." He said, "Here I am," and ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call. Lie down again." So he went and lay down. The Lord called again, "Samuel." Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call, my son. Lie down again." For now Samuel did not know yet the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel again, a third time. And he got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore Eli had said to Samuel, "Go lie down, and if he calls you, you shall say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood calling before him, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." These were the words of our Lord from 1 Samuel chapter 3, verses 1 through 10.
Let us continue singing, "Help Us Accept Each Other."
Each other as Christ accepted us. Teach us as sister, brother, each verse and to
think I'm going to have to add that to maybe my top five anthems that you sing, that you bless us with. Thank you. I'm half tempted to have you guys sing it again, but I know how much effort that takes. For our prayer today, it's going to be a little bit different. So I'm going to ask you to participate in this prayer. I hope you do every Sunday that you participate in the prayer by praying silently and along with me, but I'm going to ask you questions in this prayer. I'm going to ask you to do something during the prayer, and you'll pray that, though, just silently to yourself. So allow us to quiet our spirits, to hear and to feel God's Spirit move within us and amongst us. Let us pray. God, you are the Holy One, the source of all divine love. And you've called each of us by name. You've knit us in the womb. You've known us before we were even born. For there is no place that we can go on heaven and on earth where you cannot find us, where you will not pursue us, where you will call to us. We long to hear you call us by name as Samuel heard you call him. So we open ourselves to you. We know that you call us. Jesus, our Savior, calls us to be disciples. You will not let us lounge in bed on a Sunday. You will not allow us to be passive, but you engage us. You wake us in the middle of the night to remember. Sometimes, Lord, we wake up in the night wondering why, missing that you have called our name. And so I invite you now to pray silently where God has worked in your life this week, where God has answered a prayer for you this week, where God has called out to you this week, where God may have been just holding you this week. Lord, just as you saw Nathanael under the fig tree, you will not let us hide under the tree, for you summon us from the shade to be changed. So now I invite you to silently pray for those things that need to be changed. What things need to be changed in your life? Let's offer those to God. God, you will not let us bury our secrets within the earth, for you unearth our fears and speak them aloud. So I invite you now to pray silently and to name the fears that you have. What is it that you are afraid of? What is it that you fear? What is it that you do not face? What is it that you hide deep in the crevices of your soul? Let us name those before God. God, I know that you are ever more ready to hear than we are to speak. We don't like to see what is always before us. We don't like to confess that which we've done wrong. But yet you are there. You've called us to follow you. You've called us to come and see. You've called us out from where we're comfortable. You've moved us. So, Lord, we have come here. We have shuffled here. We have run here. We've reluctantly come here. And all those things, Lord, your arms are wide open. Move within us so that we are more willing to forgive. Move within us so we are more willing to show compassion. Move within us so that we are more willing to look forward for what lies ahead than to hold on to what is behind. Allow us to be vulnerable. Allow us to be courageous. Allow us to love. Give us the eyes of faith to see differently. Give us the eyes of faith to see even greater things, to see deeper, so that we can become, that we can be, that we may be the people that you've called us to be, each one of us, in each daily act that we do, in all things giving thanks. And so, Lord, as your children, as your community of faith, of those that are gathered here, we say to you, we pray to you the prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who have sinned against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Let us sing together our hymn of prayer. Breathe on me, breath of God.
Let us say our prayer of illumination together. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. So today we are in the Gospel of John in the first chapter, and here Jesus is calling disciples In the preceding verses, he's called Peter, Andrew, and Philip. Now, for the Gospel of John, the fact that there's 12 disciples is not a big deal. He's not worried about that. So when in our scripture today, when Jesus calls Nathanael, if you look in the Synoptic Gospels, which are Matthew, Mark, and Luke, you won't find the name of Nathanael listed. You'll not see him listed in the name of the 12 disciples. Because John is about that God, through Jesus, is calling all of us. That Jesus is calling all of us to come and see, to be. And so you'll notice this pattern that as the disciples are called, they are also out calling others. They're finding others. And so we pick up in this story, it's the fourth day in the ministry of Jesus. And so the next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee, and he found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, and Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" And Philip said to Nathanael, "Come and see." And when Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said of him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." And Nathanael asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" And Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." And Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." And Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." And he said to them, "Very truly, I tell you, you will see heaven opened and angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." Wow. Seeing even greater things. In our scriptures today, there's been three, and they all deal with epiphany. They are all about where God sees something that the person did not see. In each of these moments of epiphany, we find that no one is able to see themselves as God sees them. Nathanael, whom we just read, was merely hanging out under a fig tree. Samuel was just lying on the temple floor. Only God sees what greater things will come with these servants. Indeed, God searches us and knows us better than we know ourselves. Did we mention how old roughly Samuel was when he was being called? He's about 12. About 12. Just a little background there. I didn't get to mention it before Edward was reading. But Eli was the priest. Now, Eli had two sons. His two sons were up to no good. But Eli knew that, and Eli wasn't stopping them. They were, in essence, stealing from God, stealing from the people, and doing things that were very bad. And so God was making a change. God was going to call up a new priest, a new prophet, a new one who would lead Israel. And this was going to be Samuel. Now, Samuel was young, and he was being taught as those who would be taught in this way. He was being taught in the ways of the Lord. And so he's lying on the temple floor. He's lying right in front of the Ark of the Covenant where the lamp was still burning. You see, the authors of this text wanted you to know that the lamp of the Lord was still burning. It burned 24 hours a day. It was the Babylonians who came in and captured Israel. Those were the ones who put out the lamp. But there's Samuel, and he's called by God four times. Called by the divine presence and didn't even recognize it. So he goes into Eli, and Eli's like, no, go back. Eli finally gets it. This is God calling you. Now, God's going to reveal to Samuel some bad news for Eli, and Eli models for us. We didn't read it today, but I encourage you to. It's a pretty good story. Eli models how to accept bad news. Now, here's a challenge for the youth anyone who can find, or anybody, but preferably youth, if you can find out the name of Eli's two sons, it's in the Bible, you can have your choice of free candy out there in the narthex. Okay? Thanks, Joanne and Amy. So, two sons' names. So the kids in the first service, they found that and they all ran up to me to see who could be first. So it's two sons. So anyways, but one, there's something really cool here. Who was God talking to? A young person. So if you are young, God can speak to you. God will speak to you. God values you and loves you as much as God loves anybody else in this room. And so if you're sitting there, you might be wondering, I can't wait until God speaks to me. So our challenge is, how do we make ourselves aware of God's presence in the speaking? Last week, we reinforced the fact that Christmas was ending, that had ended. It was our first Sunday of Epiphany. We were challenged by the work of Howard Thurman to go out and do the work of Christmas, to find the lost, to heal the broken, to feed the hungry, to release the prisoner, to rebuild the nations, to bring peace among the brothers and sisters of the world, and to make music in the hearts. Why? Because we have an identity. As Jesus was baptized and given the name identity of beloved, with you I am well pleased, we are all the beloved within whom God is well pleased. We are the beloved. We have this identity. We have this purpose. We are to go out. And now here, we see where Jesus is coming for us, calling to us. The doxa, or the glory, because remember, we sing the doxology as we bring the gifts down and the elements down. We sing the doxology. But Jesus sees those with whom he's calling. He sees them before they see themselves. He finds Philip. Now, Philip had said, Jesus, we found this one about whom Moses and the prophets wrote about. You see, there's several identities that are happening in the scripture. Now, this harkens back to the Old Testament, because we can't truly appreciate who Jesus was without understanding the Old Testament scriptures. So Jesus fulfills the law and the prophets, those with whom they wrote about. Now remember, John is writing this gospel, and his gospel is different than the synoptic, the Matthew, Mark, and Luke gospels a little bit. But he's writing this gospel to help primarily his Jewish and then the Gentile believers understand who this Jesus is. Now he's given an identity, right? He's given an identity. This is the one with whom the prophets write about. And then it comes about where he says, this is Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth. When Nathaniel's like, Nazareth? Who cares about Nazareth, right? What good comes out of Nazareth? Because Nazareth was only about a town of about 200 to 400 people. Not very big, nothing special about this. And so there's this question, this tension that happens. Is this Jesus just a person? Is he truly the son of Joseph? But you see, we know more, the readers know more, because John, in the beginning of his gospel, in that prologue, has already identified who Jesus was. In verse 1, and the Word became flesh and lived among us. Not that, the other one. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. That's the very first verse. That's who Jesus Christ was. And because he was the Word and Word was with God, he comes to us in verse 14 and says to us, and the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his doxa, his glory, the glory as a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. This is the identity of who this Jesus Christ is. Remember, last week we talked about identity. Does it matter? Does it matter, our identity? And so Nathanael is seen by Jesus. And what does Jesus say? Oh, here comes this one with whom there is no deceit. How does Jesus know this? Well, John doesn't explain, but you see, this again harkens back to Psalm 32, verse 2. Happy are those to whom the Lord imputes no iniquity, in whose spirit there is no deceit. You see, John is helping us understand that this Nathanael then is this symbol of righteousness, one in which righteousness can develop. Now, Nathanael wasn't perfect, In fact, Nathanael is the one who questioned, who doubted, who was skeptical. Yet it is Jesus who reveals himself to the one who questions even the most. Jesus reveals. Now, at the end, if you remember, in verse 51, Jesus said, "Very truly I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." What story does that remind you of? You see the heavens opened up and there's angels coming up and down. The birth of Christ? Nope, wrong. What? Jacob's ladder. This big stairway, the heavens opened up, angels coming down. So what John wants us to know is that Jesus is now the locus. Jesus is now where heaven and earth meet, where the divine and the eternal meet humanity. Jesus now becomes the source upon which we experience God. So we look at Samuel, who was mistaken. We look at Nathanael, who was mistaken. And we see that it is with the eyes of faith that we are tasked to see differently. With the eyes of faith, we see that Joseph was not the father. It is with the eyes of faith where we are challenged to look around and see things differently, to be aware of maybe where have we missed the presence of God in our life? Where have we been led to do something that God was leading us to do, giving us understanding and clarity through the Holy Spirit? So Jesus reveals himself to this Nathanael who was skeptical, who doubted. But when he says, here's the one in whom there's no deceit, that means here's the one who's no guile. This is the person who expresses himself. He can't help but tell the truth. But Jesus doesn't leave him there. Because see, for Nathanael, even though he's mistaken, Jesus doesn't mock him, deride him, doesn't attack him. I mean, what do you see that happens on social media and on the news stations? I'm really having a hard time with it anymore, because every story, every response is about how we attack each other, tear the other person down, how we're offended by when someone gives their opinion, but yet we're supposed to give our opinion, yet then attacked by 20 different ways. Everybody attacks, but nobody truly, truly listens. But Jesus gives an invitation, come and see. Come and see. Jesus sees something in Nathanael. Jesus sees something in you that even you don't see. We're tasked to see with the eyes of faith. But, you know, this Jesus just doesn't leave us there. This Jesus keeps challenging us to be something greater than how we see ourselves. Moving deeper, this invitation to be what God has called you to be what the God that the world needs us to be this person that the world needs us to be the beloved child of God who invites others to experience a similarly transformative experience in this relationship with Christ. Because the disciples were going out, they were also calling others, they were teaching others. We are challenged to go out and teach the others. This year, as we talked about last Sunday, this year is all about the next step. The next step. You see, Nathanael was at the beginning point of his faith. He was going to become something even greater. He was going to truly at some point understand who he was. Now, he confessed that Jesus was rabbi, teacher, one who could help you learn something new, the Son of God, the one who is divinely appointed, King of Israel, the one who had the resources to transform. This was declared, but did Nathanael truly, truly understand the brevity, depth, width, height, love, and extent of all that that meant? But you see, it was the beginning. It's a next step. Where are you? Because some of you have had a faith for a long time. Some of you are beginning in faith. Some of you are questioning in faith. But this year, it is about you taking the next step. Now, that next step for you may be in 3 weeks. It may be in 4 months. But we take that next step together. And then when you're ready to take the next step. You see, it's about growth. It's about beginning this journey. Now, as we talked last week, you see, notice I say we talked last week. I don't want you coming to church, hearing something, and then dropping it. All this should be building. You should be able to see in your line of teaching, in your line of working through the Bible, in your line of understanding and figuring out and questioning what's going on in your spirit, you should see a movement, a progression, a foundation, a deeper understanding, something that's connected, something that doesn't let you go, where the Holy Spirit just keeps nagging and bringing this up. You see, as a community, it's about this next step. Martin Luther in 1521 in his Reformation writings wrote this about our next step, about seeing something greater. He said, "This life, therefore, is not righteousness, but growth in righteousness. Not health, but healing. Not being, but becoming. Not rest, but exercise. We are not yet what we shall be, but we are growing toward it. The process is not yet finished, but it is going on. This is not the end, but it is the road. All does not yet gleam in glory, but all is being purified." Yes, we can borrow from our Lutheran friends. It's about this journey. It's about this next step. It's about being something. So I'm going to come back to something that applies to all of us, applies to me. That even when confronted by the divine, it is possible for people to be oblivious to God's presence in their lives. Nathaniel missed it. Samuel missed it. That even when we are confronted by the divine, it is possible for us to be oblivious to God's presence in your life. That's why we take this next step, to help each of one of us realize and to wake up and to see with eyes of faith, to see the greater things that Jesus sees in us, which is why we are being called into discipleship, which is why we are being called in our faith journey. Jesus sees these greater things, to become the persons God has called us to be and that the world needs. Even when we fall short, even when we have a hard time believing, even when we don't feel worthy of God's attention or care, even when we have a hard time getting ourselves to church, Jesus calls, because Jesus sees in you even greater things. Amen.